I'm trying not to bore with too much tech stuff. The question is, why messing around with data? Why dealing with data? In continental Europe, we hate data. Data reveal our privacy, they reveal secrets, and they make us measurable. Data become performance indicators and social scores. Data feed algorithms that manipulate us. Yes, they want to question our intelligence. Data are strict, they are complicated, they are merciless. Data is the oil of the digital industrial complex, the tool of secret knowledge, an elite of mathematicians. Resist the beginnings. So why the hell messing around with data? It's as simple as it's inevitable. Data are human, a need for our human intelligence. We created them from the laws of nature. They are food and you need it. If tech does feed it, you should eat it. So let's take the challenge and meet them positively according to our values before others do. Data for good. May the math be with you. With data, you can plot complex abilities. The many interdependencies of a complex system like a city, for example. The challenge and our aspiration to manage cities as well as they can be managed has increased. If you want to save resources and increase sustainability, the human capacities alone are no longer sufficient. Climate and sustainability goals have only a flick of a chance with the support of mathematics. Such a monitoring can be seen here in the model of the London artist Stanser, who visualizes the interaction of sensors and actors in real time. Data show systematics hidden in large amounts of data and long time series, connections that you would never discover otherwise. Like the graph from the project Spiegel Mining by Daniel Kriesel. He wrote a bot and let it download Spiegel articles for years, hundreds of thousands, one of the leading media in Germany. Now he can do great things with data. Here he has shown the commentability of various topics in the course of the past years. And in addition, he sorted this attribute in regards of topics. Interestingly, it shows the fact that this quite discursive topic, Israel, is almost completely blocked from commenting. The certainly no less discussable topic, Ukraine and Russia, however, are open for commenting and bashing in all matters. More of Kriesel's work you can find out at the very funny lecture by him on a video at Chaos Congress. You see how this was the last 3 years, especially when the migration began. They increasingly shut down the commenting opportunities. With data, you can learn something, especially if they can be explored interactively. With own filters, buttons, with context information, by mouse over, and so on and so forth. I call this datafication. Also an important topic for journalism, which is in charge more than ever to convey complexities in an easy, fast, and cross-media way. As here, for example, in financing the election campaigns, various representatives in the United States. If you go over there with a mouse, you can find the connections from the donator to the representatives. This is very important for democratic education. With data, relevances can be analyzed. Here, in the visualization of the buzzword factor that the Spiegel magazine has made based on the comparison of the coalition agreements. Shown is the factor per thousand nouns. And of these, the top 30. Surprisingly, or not, that's the digitization that has made it into the top 30 the first time this coalition agreement, which is still to be accepted, for the coming period. The much criticized and escalated backlog of Germany in digitization has a system. What has no relevance in the agenda, that has almost no chance to be taken in action. Incidentally, this already begins with the collection of topics by the polling institutes. What is not asked is not on the agenda. I had this issue already with various leading institutes because the attention span of the interviewed individual during the panel is a valuable asset, which is why important questions are deleted from surveys, though. So much about the genetics of data integrity. With data, you can give information beauty, like here in the live streaming picture, based on wind open data from databases in the USA. Also here, an exciting note. This shows very nicely the difference between North America and Europe in terms of climate. While here in the North American picture, the air can flow from north to south across the continent due to the vertical shapes of the mountains, like the Rockies and the Appalachian in the east. In Europe, we are fortunate to have enough protective maritimes around and mountain ranges from west to east that protect us from weather extremes and clashing temperatures. Compare values with data, done here very nicely by activists. I have no idea what the trick by the Brits, maybe you have. That's really interesting, but this is how you can do some messages. And if you have a message based on data, you also can even paint some stats, spreading evidence and politics, but handle with care, as stats are powerful and a weapon. You can even do some nudging with stats. Make peeps have like you want, behave like you want. In this picture, you even have a double impact, people being engineered to drop their cigarettes proper into the litter box and not on the street while catching some guesses. But wait. What does this mean? Does anybody has an idea what they are talking about? Yeah. I didn't know. That was really funny. But there is a lot of incentive. It looks like a lot of incentives. So the people are being nudged very good. So create some knowledge nobody needs. That's a possibility too, like these ranked names requested by the City Council of the Mannheim during 24. But is this really needless? I have to say, those on the right are the boys, and those on the left are the girls. And I find the most popular names are Sophie and Marie. But what I find more interesting is, why is this popularity on the boys' side, this linear, and why do we have these outliers by the girls? So this is where research begins, when you do some data plotting, and this is how data-driven journalism works. And is it also useless for somebody who has a company for giveaways, for cups with names on? I would be very interested as an entrepreneur to find out in which town which names are most popular so I can do my orders like this. And what is when you're managing cultural goods? Wouldn't you be interested in the insights about the preferences and behaviors of your audience? Like here, where the data are plotted from the Internet Movie Database to find out they're plotted on the commands and the rankings and the likes to various series. And so you have the house of cards, and this is how you can shape a little bit your cultural output like that. So why now? This is like the internet looked in the early days. Very clean, very well distributed. So healthy. And this is like the internet looks now. So it's very locked in datas, and also the power is very concentrated. We have to ask us, do we want private and even foreign companies to manage and control digital public interests without a mandate? Do we want digital public interest driven by closed math, algos, and heuristics? Do we want our citizens surrender their private data to companies and leave them alone with this? Do we want this data to leave European legal space of privacy? Do we want to feed foreign economies with added value by exploiting these data and selling us artificial intelligence as a service in future, which we doesn't have our own? So what we need is to evolve the web to a distributed structure by open standards. And this is the way it works. It is Tim Berners-Lee, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the hypertext and therefore of the World Wide Web, expanded in the year 2000 his idea of the World Wide Web to evolve it from a web of hypertext and hypermedia to a web of data. An open web of data, a web of linked open data, where semantics brings context to data, the semantic web. I have a dream of the web, and it has two parts. In the first part, the web becomes a much more powerful means for collaboration between people I have. I have always imagined the information space as something to which everyone has immediate and intuitive access. In the second part of the dream, collaborations extend to computers. Machines become capable of analyzing all the data, a semantic web which should make this possible as yet to emerge, but when it does, the day-to-day mechanism of trade, bureaucracy, and our daily lives will be handled by machines, taking to machines, leaving humans to provide for inspiration and intuition. This is how the semantic work grew in the last 10 years. Reason is the RDF scheme, to describe data and link them by machine-readable descriptions. You even can embed this in HTML and XHTML. So this is a way we should think when we think about open data from audience data we generated, to have them open so that everybody can do something with it. And we don't speak about privacy connected data. We don't think about data which has to be in, to be a secret from the view of the general security. But this is how data will be crawled in the internet, like we crawl our web pages the last 20 years. So there are different qualities of open data. So you have an open license you need. This is very important because mostly people speak about technical interoperability, but mostly people forget to think about legal interoperability. So if we don't want to spend all our added values using data into the pockets of lawyers having a bunch of different licenses, we need to do the most easy flowing license, which are open license. And you have here this cascade of the qualities until you have a linked data context with open data sets. And to add value, you have a cycle where you can cross those data in the different refining levels until you have an output, a pure use, and from this you mostly get those quality and integrity in a better way. We also have to think about a periodic system. Data react like chemicals. So you have some data which aren't very useful, maybe. Some data, like geodata, are very useful mostly, and they react very fast with other data. And then we have radioactive data. Those are problematic data. So this would be an idea to find out how can we build a set of data like a periodic system. And what is the open idea in general? So the more you get open, the more you have the possibility to do open innovation and have external intersectoral competencies in your processes to innovate. And there's a historic moment of this. This was in the 1945, 54, where there was a very strong disease in London, and the public bodies had no idea where this came from. And there was one guy, Dr. Snow. He said, "Okay, let's give me our data, your data, your public body data, and let's do some geo profiling." And he found out that there's there are a lot of cases around a pump, a Brunnen, and that there might be a problem. So it was like this, that there was the source of the disease. And you have this nowadays is the same way, like here in California, somebody mapped the data, the stats about mental illness, poverty, and the distribution of psychiatrists, and found out that this doesn't make sense. So the psychiatrists are there where the rich people are, the most mental illness is there where the poor people are, and this doesn't match. So you have somebody who is from the civil society showing this up to the public bodies. Currently, we are finding out what can be, how are the indicators built, what data are needed for the SDG goals of the United Nations. And there's also a 2030 watch tool from the Open Knowledge Foundation, which collect this data so that we as a civil society, as external, have a view on the progress reaching the sustainable goals. In Heidelberg, for example, with open data, we did this, that we found somebody at the university who has the maths for routing in an accessible way for people who are handicapped. And This is the way Google shows the routing for pedestrians, and this is the way you have to take when you're handicapped and on a wheelchair. So we are building this and got the money from the Ministry Interior of Baden-Württemberg. And also we are currently starting a project to bring together cultural data, also repros from public domain arts and transport data from the public transport and data from touristic to have a routing, like when I have 8 hours time with kids and it's about the Baroque time, epoch, you can say, give me a route, where can I find what, in which museum, in which point of interest, somewhere in nature or somewhere is connected with the topic of Baroque epoch. So this is the way we think about this. Now we have we're targeting for 3.5 million. Now we have 120,000 for a study how we can set this up. So open data is a must, and this is very important because to have really a fluid system of working data, you need the methods and the measurements. Consensus in this collective. You have. You need also then the open standards for that. You need the technical interoperability. You need the syntactic interoperability. The semantic, that what I told before, is very important. And of course, the legal interoperability, so that you have the most chance to get some added value from your data. Also, open data in the license and reuse view is now law. It's a law by the European Union, which has been adopted by the national laws. It's called the Public Sector Information Reuse Directive in Germany. It's made to the, it was adopted to the Informationsweiterverwendungsgesetz. You have this in different in all member states now, which allows everybody to reuse data from the public sector, from the license perspective. And this is why Europe is one of the main driver of open data, because they know that there is that we have to build our own digital added value system with our European values and to build up a digital single market. So there are a lot of funding instruments also coming from European Union attached to open data. And the third is, we even don't know what is the ownership from data, especially those data which are generated in interactions. And this gets more and more data generated in interactions. So they are not materialistic, definitely not. And they are nor a creation of art. So what are they? They are still examining and researching what they will put data as a good, what kind of good this will be in future. That's the main main question for handling this data in general from the view of a copyright issue. And so I leave you alone now with this and wish you a nice conference. Thank you. Thank you.